Welcome to the WTFFF special series, brought to you by the Z and 3D print teams from HP, where your hosts, Tom and Tracy Hazard, explore the all about the what of 3D workflows from concept to print.
Welcome back to WTFFF. I'm Tracy Hazard.
Along with Tom Hazard. And we are excited to bring to you an episode we recorded in the past, but it's still relevant today in this series with HP, and we want to share with you why it is and actually share some new information as well.
Well, really, it's a follow-up to the last episode where we were talking about sustainability. Now, we were talking about broader sustainability, not just the sort of recycling green aspect. And then we had this episode that we recorded. It was called Easy Going Green. And so we're bringing it back for you here. So these are some of those episodes we told you. This is the first one in the series where we're bringing back one of our more popular episodes, but we're bringing back because the topic is still really relevant. Of course, we're going to add a little bit here at the beginning to talk about and put it back into context for you, especially with what we were discussing last episode when we were talking about sustainability as a whole, and also putting it into context with what's going on today and how the marketplace is and how the economy is and how the ecosystem is overall in terms of sustainability. But you'll find out at the early part of the episode that I used to write a blog called Easy Going Green. It was like a long time ago.
That's like so long ago.
I know.
I don't even remember what year it was, but it was
I think it was like 2007 or 8, something like that. Yeah.
You did it long before we started WTFFF.
Long before. Huh. So I used to have this blog and we would experiment with different things that we were trying to do to try to go sustainable. And we talk about that in the episode. So I'm going to leave that for that. But I just wanted to give you the framework why we call it Easy Going Green is because it related to that. But we're really talking about 3D print sustainability and 3D manufacturing sustainability was a little bit more of the topic and some of the things that we were adding last time. But we really want to cover this sort of 3D print sustainability from the perspective, and what we want to bring you in this intro piece here is from the perspective of small to medium-sized businesses. And when really thinking about what can you do, how can you operate, what ideas are new, what things are going on, and is it more of a struggle today than it was, you know, even a decade ago for us? And there are some things that are. So that's where we're revisiting this episode, and we're going to talk about some of these 3D print sustainability challenges.
Well, and I think we have to mention about some sustainability challenges for business in general today, right, in the context of where we are in 2020, because there are some big environmental impacts going on that I don't think anybody thought we were going to be facing at the beginning of this year.
Right. So, you know, looking at a post-COVID world, as we keep calling it, right, you know, or a mid-COVID world is actually where we're recording this, but hopefully by the time you're listening to it, and maybe we'll be post-COVID in many areas, who knows? So, you know, that we can always hope for that. But, you know, when we're looking at pandemic issues, things that are going on, and we have some positive opportunities and some positive things that are happening, like we saw a cleanup overall to the carbon footprint of the world when manufacturing shut down for a period of time, when people aren't in their cars and driving and all of those things are going on. So we saw improvements, and you know, there's like NASA data on that. And I love the space station images.
Yeah. I mean, the environment in terms of the atmosphere, I want to really carve this out because I think there are other environmental aspects that I want to acknowledge are not benefiting, but the atmosphere has been benefiting a great deal, as you said, Tracy, from, you know, the perspective of manufacturing shutting down, but also transportation. Obviously, so much less air travel. The air out here in, you know, Southern California, where we are, has improved tremendously, the air quality, and even it's visible. You can see it looking to the mountains. But also, we haven't had any smog alerts or health alerts for breathing, and that's great on the one hand. On the other hand, I don't know about where any of you live who are listening to this, but where we are, a lot of our grocery stores are no longer letting us use our own bags.
Well, we have a law here in California where you have to use bags or you have to pay. So you end up having to pay for paper or pay for plastic to and use the store's bags or buy the store's bags at that point. So that's been waived here and removed. And now it's all, we've all backpedaled and we can't even bring our own bags into the stores anymore.
And in fact, I find that the grocery store clerks packing all of our groceries are putting fewer groceries in a normal paper bag than I would, like at Trader Joe's, for instance. Way more paper bags, a lot more waste, more things to recycle. This is not having a good environmental impact.
Well, and it's not just that, but we have a supply problem of materials right now. And so thinking about a world where the shutdown happened, we couldn't recycle things. Like the recycling was not happening in most regions of the country. So we weren't getting the supply chain buildup of recycled plastics, which we see, which tend to go into manufacturing at a great level. Like we used to make a lot of chair bases and other things. And there's a high percentage of recycled plastic content in there. And if everything's shut down in manufacturing, they're not buying that. So there's no source for that at that moment. So our supply chains are suffering from a source material problem. And so we're seeing that across the board in so many materials that there isn't enough recycled materials. We also had the personal problem of, well, we're stuck in our house. So what do? We clean our cabinets and our closets and, you know, clean out all the excess toys. We couldn't even donate them. And 1 month past being released from sequestering, we still couldn't find anyone to donate them. We had to trash them. We had to send them. Now, they promised, the people we sent it to, and paid to have our stuff removed, mind you. We could have recycled it for free and given it a donation, but we paid to have it removed from our driveway, basically. And when that happened, they promised us that they would do their best to sell it and recycle it and do what they were going to do with it and donate it and do that. But, you know, who knows if that really happened, right? Because it's still the Salvation Army's, the
Goodwills of the world.
Goodwills are not open yet. And so they've been out, you know, so we need to rethink essential services and recycled materials, donations, all of those things are actually essential to our supply chain. And that is where we're going to see problems and hiccups along the way for the next year. That's my estimation on it.
And I want to acknowledge the very negative environmental impact going on from the impact of COVID-19 in terms of, you know, personal protective equipment with hospitals. I mean, there's so many materials in gowns and masks, and obviously there's been a shortage of masks, and we talk about that. And but there are, just in terms of gloves and gowns, just even take that or whatever you're protecting your body with in these hospitals. They are changing them and using more and more disposable materials. There is a very negative, I think, landfill impact and really a demand of recycling that doesn't exist. So many people trying maybe to recycle plastic gowns, all these things that there's not enough infrastructure to recycle them. And so this is presenting a challenge.
And thinking about this, the restaurants opening up, they have a lot of disposable menus and other things that they're doing. And many restaurants are only using disposable plates and plasticware. And that's awful to begin with.
But, yeah. And let's take another example. We just experienced, you know, the day before recording this episode, you go out to a sushi restaurant and you used to have the bottle of soy sauce in the middle of your table that you would just pour what you needed. Very efficient and environmentally friendly, but now because they don't want, you have to clean the bottle between every use.
There's no shared materials.
No shared materials. You're getting all these disposable little packets as if you were ordering food to go of soy sauce. And so that packaging increase of use and manufacturing and packaging is going to have a negative environmental impact.
Right. And we are seeing a lot of individual packaging going on. So even in the product planning part, we're seeing the packaging changes going on there that use up a lot more materials. So now we have more demand for materials and less materials, especially less source materials coming in from a recycle standpoint. So we are going to see that it's not going to be so easy going green, and that 3D print sustainability is actually really necessary right now. And so when we talk about the benefits of going green from a 3D print perspective, and we look at it from, you know, the ability to have just from sort of, I'm going to call it from a brand perspective, we're going to talk about that first, right? Providing a competitive advantage that we're using this technology, we're using these things so that we're using less materials to create items to begin with. We are making them lighter so that if we do have to ship them, they're lighter to ship. We are possibly not having to ship them at all because we're making them on site, right?
That's what I was going to say. Certainly, but you have already, an infrastructure in the United States, and I would argue in most modern countries in the world where there is a 3D print ecosystem and infrastructure, you've got 3D print materials already distributed locally.
Right.
And you have 3D printers already existing in every state and every city in the United States. So why ship something when you can make it locally? And maybe it, this is an example, like with the masks, people are making 3D printed locally, and, you know, other things we've talked about in some of the other episodes with regarding PPE or, you know, in the hospitals, there's a big opportunity there to be sustainable.
Right. And so I want you to think about this is if this is right for your small to medium sized business, this is what right for what you're doing. If you have 50 to 200 employees, thinking about the various ways at which you might be able to be more 3D print sustainable and manufacturing sustainable in general too. So, you know, some of the ideas that we were tossing around was that a lot of times you make products and you buy too much inventory of something. So you have too much of something that you don't need. It's a really good example is when we put out a piece of furniture or a brand new product into the marketplace, they make a lot of replacement parts. And so we may not need those replacement parts if we had a 3D print sustainability plan to how we are going to maintain products. So we may not need that excess inventory. We also don't have to truck it. We don't have to house it. We don't have to do all of those other, have people who take it off a shelf and remove it. We, you know, so it's a lot more efficient overall in how we look at that. So that can be a significant competitive advantage. So we really urge you to think and look through the things that you're buying, the way that you're buying them, and look and see if there's a 3D print alternative that you could do, which would save you, because then the only thing you need is some filament or powders or whatever machine and system you're using. That's really efficient because you utilize them in so many different parts and products.
And not only that, Tracy, I mean, I don't know about any of you, our listeners out there, but, you know, from my own perspective, in the world of still in the midst of COVID-19 and various stages of opening up, you know, of businesses, the last thing that I want to do as someone in a company that needs to procure things or even as a consumer, the last thing I want to do is go driving around to a bunch of different locations of different distributors or stores or places in order to get things that I need. If I can 3D print it and not have to drive anywhere and not have to deal with putting on my mask going into another facility, or do they have a mask rule in this city where I'm going? Am I going into this? Do I need to call ahead and figure it out? Oh my gosh. Logistically, I would much rather 3D print something that I need.
Just do it here and be done with it, right? Yeah. Exactly. And so, you know, when we think about needing a more robust system at home, in our offices, in our manufacturing facilities, we need this to be the reality in case we need to go through this again, right? And God forbid we have to go through it again, but it can happen. And we look at that and say, we have got to protect ourselves with more sustainability in our whole supply chain management, in our whole manufacturing structure, in our whole sourcing structure for our own homes, our own businesses. And is there ways at which we could utilize 3D printing in that process? And this is where great innovation is going to happen. You know, so let's talk about some of the, you know, before we head into the full episode here, I just want to hit some of the changes that Tom and I both believe are going to have the biggest impact. Because the impact matters the most. So, you know, it's great. Look, I learned this from Easygoing Green, right? And like we took away laundry detergent and replaced it with soap nuts. We took away paper towels and replaced them with cloth. Like we did a bunch. We drew the line at toilet paper and diapers, but you know, we were on a path. And you know, we would try them, and you would say, was there benefit to this? Was there impact in this? Did we create an impact both on a money side? And we always looked at it, and that was one important thing. We always looked at it from an economic standpoint. So green meant not just making something, you know, environmentally green, but it made more sense in that it put more money back in our pockets and in our budgets. And that's how we looked at it from both perspectives. It needs to do both to be right and to be useful.
It does. And I'd like to say, just to throw in here, Tracy, you know, when we started that journey ourselves, you know, getting rid of paper towel was a bit of an adjustment And for me, and I think it was more mindset though.
Yeah.
But I have to say, what's it been now? 12 years later or something, at least. I forget, maybe more.
We had a puppy and we had a pack of paper towels for a while there, and that was it.
Like, well, yeah, when the puppy was
because we were going through
training.
Too many.
but other than that, quite honestly, for 12 years, we use towels that are ones we wash, and we have them in a drawer in our kitchen, and we just don't use paper towels. So when it came to COVID-19 and there was a run on toilet paper and a run on any paper products, paper towels, especially in all the grocery stores, and I don't know about where you are, but where we live, you couldn't get anything in your normal
We never buy napkins or paper towels. So like, right. We didn't have any of those problems. We did have toilet paper issues, but like everybody else, but we managed to get ourselves into Costco early enough to get ours. But you know, this is the thing. It's like, we do want a more sustainability model for ourselves and our businesses. And what can have some of the biggest impact? Well, I mean, the most obvious one is making any kind of products, any kind of things that you use, buy, do, right? Less manufacturing, waste, water, and energy. Those are the three biggest things you can do to have an overall impact. When I talk energy, though, I'm always thinking transportation, which is like the next biggest impact. And we design products like that all the time. I mean, Tom and I were always trying to find ways to make smaller footprints for our furniture. Now, you know, there's a fine line between making ready to assemble furniture that makes people like, you know, scream at the designer. And there's, you know, we used to call it like, is this a six pack or more of beer to put it together, right?
Yeah.
You know, and so like, you know, there's always that frustration level. And that's, so we have to run that fine line between, is this useful and helping us with major transportation issues, weight issues, energy issues, consumption from that perspective, and a smaller footprint overall. But is it also complicating the lives of the user and the assembler so much that we can't do that? So there's always a fine line and a trade-off that have to be made. But if you can make a trade-off and lower transportation weights and sizes, you're going to help everyone. Because when a product weighs more, and that's something like, even if it takes up the same footprint, when a product weighs more, it uses more fuel. And so that's always an issue, whether you're air freighting or boat freighting, you know, it doesn't matter, or trucking, right? It doesn't matter which way it's coming over. That is a significant impact, environmental impact that you can have by removing weight. Smaller footprints in general are better, right?
Well, you know, in general, you would think it would be. Smaller footprints are better. And you know, by considering those things as we're developing products, you can hopefully make a bigger impact. Right.
Right. And this is a post-COVID conversation, because we're now talking about restaurants, office spaces, which are not putting as much capacity into a smaller footprint, right? Now they're opening up those spaces, requiring more spaces between everything. And there's personal benefit. Health benefits to that, but there's also an environmental impact to having to have a larger space to air condition, to heat, to, you know, to do these things, and of course a big cost to them as well, with less efficient output. So, you know, really thinking carefully about, how can I do things that are more efficient in a smaller footprint? How can I create this environmental innovation, product innovation? These are the ways at which you can benefit, and you can make a bigger impact into helping our future here in terms of making more 3D print sustainability and more 3D manufacturing sustainability, or more just in general, environmental sustainability. And then the last thing that we think has the biggest impact, Tom, is, and we try to do this all the time, and it's thinking what we call cradle to cradle, not cradle to grave, because that implies somewhere along the line, it's done in the process. So can we use materials? Can we choose to combine materials that can be taken apart so that each part can be recycled, so they can be easily, when we commingle things, which 3D printing is not friendly for commingling. Because it's like you have to stop a print. If you're doing like an FFF style printing, you have to stop a print, put another material in, like do these things. When you're doing the fused powder materials, the materials themselves have some cases are commingled within themselves, but you know, because they're not always 100% pure. So when you've got metal, you sometimes have plastic in there, right? So, you know, that's an issue, but thinking about how we can do that more efficiently and what kind of materials we can create so that they themselves can become a full cradle to cradle, going back into that recycle chain, is going to help us all with our supply chain management.
Yeah, you've got to design and develop products thinking about the sustainability issues like this, and the different combinations of materials and parts, and how you're going to be able to separate them to either create a replacement part that may wear out in time without having to replace the whole product, or how you're going to separate and recycle or reuse different materials. And it's more important now than ever, I think.
I agree. Creating a sustainable supply chain management system is going to benefit you in the future. This is a long-term economic benefit, but it's also a protection plan for another COVID rebound, you know, or anything like that. So thinking about those things, these are the things that you can have the biggest impact in your goal of sustainability and in goal for a more sustainable business model, as well as just 3D print sustainability, which why not, you know, from that perspective. So I hope you guys enjoy the rest of the episodes, so the replay of our episode from before, and so you can get a little taste of the kinds of things that we were talking about, because we'll get a little bit more specific into 3D printing there and this into sustainability related to 3D printing.
So we hope you enjoy it. It's still relevant today. Obviously, you know, it is an older episode, but check it out. We hope you enjoy it. And then we'll be back for the next episode really soon.
Hey, everyone. This is Tom and Tracy on the WTFFF 3D Printing Podcast. And since this week is Earth Day, we've decided to do this entire week themed Earth Week here on WTFFF.
Yeah, we think we're like NBC or a CBS, and they have like the, you know, their green logo for the week or whatever.
They do that.
So we're going to do our lip service and hopeful community service to 3D printing going green.
Absolutely. And we've got some good topics lined up for you all week on this. I don't think that any of our listeners really understand, Tracy, that a few years back, you had a blog called Easy Going Green, and you had press credentials and were going to different trade shows and traveling around the country and as part of our business, and you were writing on these sorts of green issues.
Well, it actually even predated our current form of the business. So it was before our now almost 7-year-old was born. And so, yes, I was writing. It was called Easy Going Green, and the blogs were, I have a history of working with great environmentally forward companies. They care about it. Herman Miller cared about it. Milliken cared about it. And what I really found from working with them, and that's why I decided to start the blog and talk about it, is that they firmly believed that going green was not just something you talked about, and it was not just something you did because it was the right thing to do. That was a part of it, but they did it because it was also business sustainable. And so going green, the implication was that it was for making money doing that, it being profitable doing it. And so I used to write blogs about how you could save money going green.
You know, actually, there are lots of legitimate companies out there that are going green. They're finding that they're able to go green, and not to their detriment, but actually to their benefit. And here, you know, it's easy in California. I mean, we see a lot of this, especially with energy. Every house in our neighborhood has solar panels on it. Almost everybody's putting electricity on the grid. There are so many Priuses and Nissan Leafs electric cars out here in California. You can't even drive down the street 1 mile without seeing 3 or 4 of them.
Well, yeah, let me just give a couple of examples of some things. So I would talk about it in terms of blogs that were personal. So some things that we were doing at home to change to being green personally. I would talk about how some companies that I knew and profiled were doing it in a larger format way. And then I was talking about it in terms of product design, because obviously that's our experience and that's our background. And so Easy Going Green would be things like we took out paper towels. And we took out paper towels, and
we
I would calculate.
Yeah, I often forget about that. I'm so used to it now.
We just don't use it. And, you know, the thing is that there's a debate, and you have to have that debate, because it's not right in every area and for every person to go ahead and do that. And so you have to look at the bigger picture of something. And this is where people get paralyzed and don't do anything. They think it's just overwhelming. Why go green? Because somebody's going to tell me that, like my dad does all the time, tell you that, why do you have an electric car? Because fuel is so low cost right now that it's equal and it's not going to be a big difference. And it costs so much to build the batteries and to build the car that you're still carbon emission.
I tuned out somewhere in there.
Yeah, you know, this is the kind of thing. And so there's always a counter argument.
Right.
But my point is that if you, though, bottom line it for your personal household or your personal business or, you know, whatever it is that you're working on, that criteria is the only criteria that matters. That's how you make it easy going green, for you to decide what is worth going green on. So for us, we looked around and we said, well, water's not expensive here. I know it's a commodity, but we're already washing laundry. So adding a few dish towels into that laundry anyway is going to increase the load. It's not going to be more use of water. None of that's going to happen. We hadn't anticipated having two more babies at that time when we first started doing it. So you really didn't anticipate how much laundry loads we do. So now it's even more efficient than when I originally calculated.
Definitely. I agree. We would run the same number of loads of laundry regardless of if we washed all our dish towels in the kitchen every week.
Yes, exactly. So it didn't make a difference from a water use standpoint for us. But the cost savings on removing paper towels from our grocery list because of how much we would consume was tremendous over the course of a year. So you're talking about a good $500 to $800 savings just right there from one item you changed in your system. So we looked at that and we said, well, that's worth changing. I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm not a penny pincher, but I was like, it's not going to hurt us to not have that. It's not like spills aren't going to get wiped up. We drew a line at toilet paper. Tom's looking at me.
Well, you were definitely in your earthy, crunchy phase of your life. You were going organic food-wise and, you know, looking at all sorts of environmental issues. And when you read things and you start to get on a mission, you're on a mission and watch out. You know, you don't want to get in Tracy's way when she's on that. But anyway, I don't know. I don't even remember at this point. It's been so long if I resisted the paper towel thing or not. But
well, it was paper towels and then it was like laundry detergent, and there was a couple other things we tried. Now, we quickly gave up on the laundry detergent, but...
Oh, my gosh. She used to use nuts for laundry detergent. You actually would put these soap nuts, which are a natural thing, in a little cloth bag, and that was your soap, and I don't think it worked very well. But
no, and we determined quickly that it wasn't getting stuff clean enough, and when the babies came around, we said, forget that, and we quickly switched over. But I was trying to, more than in that case, stop buying laundry detergent or whatever, I was trying to reduce the chemical load on our own bodies.
Sure.
So there's a little different driver. So that's the way I look at it, is if you want to improve your air quality, what's important to you? If you want to improve the amount of chemicals that are getting put onto your body and into your body, that's another way to do it. And that's one of the reasons why we go organic, you know, but we don't really go wild with organic. We go organic with, you know, the major ones that have major toxic chemicals.
Well, you know, thinking about how this all relates to 3D printing, and we're going to be talking about some things later in the week regarding air quality and the toxicity potentially of some of the materials we're printing in 3D printing. We believe in this 3D printing industry, and it is primarily plastic, right? So how does this easygoing green and earthquake, what are your thoughts on how this relates to all of us involved in 3D printing?
Well, I think there are ways that 3D printing can save the planet.
I like it.
My ways are that you could move to a zero inventory retail model. So if stores didn't carry as much inventory because it was printed on demand, could you imagine that life? That would be just amazingly awesome. But you're not just saving in terms of having stuff not made and then being unused and tossed. You're not making things and transporting them.
Right.
So you have that. There is a study done by the U.S. Postal Service, believe it or not, that they believed that 3D printing was going to save the post office, the U.S. Post Office. Because they
believe, that seems a little counterintuitive.
I know it does. But here's the thing. Because so many things are done by freight and trucking, you know, you truck large quantities of product, right? And also by express. But 3D printed items are so light and somewhat small in scope that they believe that people would find it more cost effective to be sending it via the U.S. Postal Service 2-day or standard mail, and that it would save the post office. So I will link that article in our blog post here. But I thought, wow, so they're not wrong. That lighter material, even if it isn't being done through the post office, but lighter materials being transported, whenever something is lighter, there's lower gas usage.
You know, that makes perfect sense when you think about it, because let's face it, every plastic product on this earth manufactured, and I don't care what manufacturing process you would use, whether it's injection molded or blow molded, rotationally molded or thermoformed, and I'm sure there's some more processes I'm forgetting in there, but wouldn't matter. You're using material that is solid. It's a solid wall thickness all the time, whatever it is. And I remember when we were first starting to manufacture components of chairs in China that we do for, you know, office chairs and such.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
Some of those arms on these chairs are really, really thick. And I always wondered, oh gosh, are those shells? Are they two pieces put together so they're thin and hollow? And they weren't. They were actually manufacturing things that had like 2-inch cross sections that were solid nylon materials. Like, oh my gosh, that's a lot of plastic
in
there.
It's a lot of plastic.
And so think about 3D printing, and now the entire way that's done with infill, which produces a good structure in there, but there's a lot of air in there. I see where you're going. That makes a lot of sense that there's an environmental benefit to that.
Right. So there's also energy use savings. So you're not running the machine all the time to make a certain level of run that then won't be used. So you have an energy use savings. Plus 3D printers, as far as I can tell, just don't use as much energy. I have not seen any reports on any 3D printer that uses as much energy as, let's say, an injection molded machine or anything like that.
That's a great point, Tracy. And you know what I'll do? I've got some video somewhere in our archives of some of the injection mold equipment producing some of the products we've designed for retail over in China primarily. But I have some video shot of some of those things cycling. When you see those big machines, they're huge. They're moving tons and tons of metal, like clamping them together, pulling them apart, clamping together, pulling them apart. And then the heat they have to generate in order to heat up what are gallons and gallons of plastic at a time, even if the part they're producing is using a 16th of a gallon of that material, you have to heat up a large volume of it, and that takes a lot of energy. And then to inject it with that pressure and heat into there, per part that's made on an injection molding machine is got to be using a lot more energy than per part of equal volume on a 3D printer. They've got to be using a lot less electricity. I mean, you're only heating up this tiny little extruder, this tiny little heat block, and you don't have all that weight it's moving around.
Exactly. So the other thing is that it's obviously, it's not zero waste, but it's very low waste.
Oh, no. I agree. It's very low waste. Compared to a lot of the same processes, I would agree. Maybe the only one that really has zero, well, more closer to zero waste might be rotational molding.
Yes, they do.
But they do sometimes cut out pieces after the fact. That
yeah,
ends
but
up
you
being
might do that. You might drill
out. You can regrind that and throw it in usually, yeah.
So anyway, but very low waste.
Yep, I agree.
And then you have to think about it from a more localized perspective. So you're creating higher skilled jobs to 3D print and design, and those jobs can be virtual. So then you have less people commuting to an office. You have people starting up a hub and doing all of those things. Plus you have localized printing. So you're now localized printing in your local community rather than having factories overseas or factories all over the place. And so even if it only changes 1% of the overall retail consumer products on the market, the impact on the environment could start to turn things around and save the planet.
Oh, think about it. 1% of everything in Walmart, how many hundreds of thousands of SKUs do they have in their store?
Oh, I think it's a huge amount. Close to a million. It's way up there.
And so you take 1% of that, you got 10,000 SKUs then. That's 1% of a million.
10,000 SKUs probably times a minimum of 100,000 units per year that they're normally running in inventory. I mean,
yeah, depending on the size of the product, I think that's right.
Yeah.
So I think eventually when the executive leadership for corporations like Walmart and Target and some of these big ones, when it really clicks in their minds, and I know it hasn't yet, but when it really clicks in their minds that they can save the amount of dollars they're committing to carrying inventory, doing this local manufacturing zero inventory model on even a fraction of their products, they're going to be some serious corporate initiatives pushing people, making it their entire mission in their job to do that.
Exactly.
That's going to happen.
We're going to do what we can to keep pushing it from that side. But that is ways that I believe 3D printing can save the planet.
I love it. I think it's
easy.
Yeah.
I don't think that's hard. None of these things are hard. The hard thing is which ones to convert.
And maybe the hard thing is changing the paradigms of the people in control. That's probably the two biggest
issues. None of these things are so controversial that they make it to the point of which you're like, no, that's in debate. You know, oh, zero waste. Well, I think you can pretty much see that there's low waste. I mean, you can pretty much see there's not a lot of waste coming out of the machine.
Right.
Like, these are really apparent, obvious savings. So,
well, I think it's a great way to kick off Earth Week.
Thanks
a lot, Tracy. I like that.
If you want to get in touch with us, though, don't forget at HazDesign, HazDesign, anywhere on social media.
Or come to our blog post at 3dstartpoint.com and leave a comment in the show notes for this episode, or just you can ask a question at the bottom of the homepage.
Yeah, and if I have missed any ways that 3D printing can save the planet, tell me. I totally want to hear them.
Please. Hey, this is an open dialogue with you, and you know we have some good ideas, but we don't have all of them. So
that's right.
Love to hear from you all.
So thanks again for listening. This is Tracy and Tom.
And this has been the WTFFF 3D Printing Podcast.
Thanks for listening to the WTFFF special series brought to you by the Z and 3D print teams from HP. You can access all the resources mentioned in this episode and all the other episodes in this series by going to 3dstartpoint.com/HP. We invite you to reach out to us on social at 3D Startpoint and at Z by HP and let us know what you are creating in 3D.